Donald Henry Rumsfeld was born on July 9, 1932, in Chicago, Illinois, the son of Jeanette Kearsley and George Donald Rumsfeld. His father came from a German family that had emigrated in the 1870s from Weihe in Lower Saxony, 15-16, but young Donald was sometimes ribbed about looking like a tough Swiss. 16 and 31 growing up in Winnetka, Illinois, Rumsfeld became an Eagle Scout in 1949 and is the recipient of both the Distinguished Eagle Scout Award from the Boy Scouts of America and its Silver Buffalo Award in 2006. Living in Winnetka, his family attended a congregational church. From 1943 to 1945, Rumsfeld lived in Coronado, California, while his father was stationed on an aircraft carrier in the Pacific in World War II. He was a ranger at Philmont Scout Ranch in 1949. Rumsfeld attended Baker Demonstration School, and later graduated from New Trier High School. He attended Princeton University on academic and Rock partial scholarships. He graduated in 1954 with an A.B. in politics after completing a senior thesis titled The Steel Seizure Case of 1952 and Its Effects on Presidential Powers. During his time at Princeton, he was an accomplished amateur wrestler, becoming captain of the varsity wrestling team, and captain of the lightweight football team playing defensive back. While at Princeton, he was friends with another future Secretary of Defense, Frank Carlucci. Rumsfeld married Joyce P. Pearson on December 27, 1954. They had three children, six grandchildren, and one great-grandchild. He attended Case Western Reserve University School of Law and Georgetown University Law Center, but did not take a degree from either institution. Naval Service. Lieutenant Donald Rumsfeld during his service with the United States Navy, in front of a Grumman S-2 tracker aircraft in 1957. As a command pilot and naval aviator, Rumsfeld flew the Grumman S-2 tracker during his service with the United States Navy. Rumsfeld served in the United States Navy from 1954 to 1957, as a naval aviator and flight instructor. His initial training was in the North American SNJ Texan Basic Trainer, after which he transitioned to the T-28 Advanced Trainer. In 1957, he transferred to the Naval Reserve and continued his naval service and flying in administrative assignments as a drilling reservist. On July 1, 1958, he was assigned to Anti-Submarine Squadron 662 at Naval Air Station Anacostia, District of Columbia, as a selective reservist. Rumsfeld was designated aircraft commander of Anti-Submarine Squadron 731 on October 1, 1960, at Naval Air Station Grosset, Ela, Michigan, where he flew the S-2F tracker. He transferred to the Individual Ready Reserve when he became Secretary of Defense in 1975 and retired with the rank of captain in 1989. In 1957, during the Dwight D. Eisenhower administration, Rumsfeld served as administrative assistant to David S. Dennison, Jr., a congressman representing the 11th District of Ohio. In 1959, he moved on to become a staff assistant to Congressman Robert P. Griffin of Michigan. Engaging in a two-year stint with an investment banking firm, A.G. Becker & Company, from 1960 to 1962, Rumsfeld instead set his sights on becoming a member of Congress. He was elected to the United States House of Representatives for Illinois' 13th Congressional District in 1962, at the age of 30, and was re-elected by large majorities in 1964, 1966, and 1968. While in Congress, he served on the Joint Economic Committee, the Committee on Science and Aeronautics, and the Government Operations Committee, as well as on the subcommittees on military and foreign operations. He was also a co-founder of the Japanese-American Interparliamentary Council in addition to being a leading co-sponsor of the Freedom of Information Act. Rumsfeld resigned from Congress in 1969, his fourth term, to serve President Richard Nixon and his administration, and served in a variety of executive branch positions throughout the Nixon presidency. In 1969, Nixon sought to reform and reorganize the United States Office of Economic Opportunity, an organization created during the Kennedy administration and greatly expanded as a part of Lyndon Johnson's Great Society programs, rather than eliminate it outright. He appointed Rumsfeld director of the organization with cabinet rank. Rumsfeld had voted against the creation of EO when he was in Congress and later said that he initially rejected Nixon's offer, citing his own inherent belief that the EO did more harm than good, and he felt that he was not the right person for the job. 119-121 he only accepted after personal pleas from the president. As director, Rumsfeld sought to reorganize the office to serve as a laboratory for experimental programs, 125 several beneficial anti-poverty programs were saved by allocating funds to them from other less successful government programs. During this time, he hired Frank Carlucci and Dick Cheney to serve under him. In February 1973, Rumsfeld left Washington to serve as U.S. Ambassador to the North Atlantic Treaty Organization in Brussels, Belgium. He served as the United States' permanent representative to the North Atlantic Council and the Defense Planning Committee, and the Nuclear Planning Group. In this capacity, he represented the United States in wide-ranging military and diplomatic matters, and was asked to help mediate a conflict on behalf of the United States between Cyprus and Turkey. In August 1974, after Nixon resigned as president in the aftermath of the Watergate scandal, Rumsfeld was called back to Washington to serve as the transition chairman for the new president, Gerald Ford. He had been Ford's confidant since their days in the House, before Ford was House Minority Leader. As the new president became settled in, Ford appointed Rumsfeld White House Chief of Staff, where he served from 1974 to 1975. In October 1975, Ford reshuffled his cabinet in the Halloween Massacre. He named Rumsfeld to succeed James Schlesinger as the 13th U.S. Secretary of Defense and George H.W. Bush to become Director of Central Intelligence. According to Bob Woodward's 2002 book Bush at War, a rivalry developed between the two men and Bush Sr. was convinced that Rumsfeld was pushing him out to the CIA to end his political career. At the Pentagon, Rumsfeld oversaw the transition to an all-volunteer military. He sought to reverse the gradual decline in the defense budget and to build up U.S. strategic and conventional forces, undermining Secretary of State Henry Kissinger at the SALT talks. He asserted, along with Team B, that trends in comparative U.S.-Soviet military strength had not favored the United States for 15 to 20 years and that, if continued, they would have the effect of injecting a fundamental instability in the world. For this reason, he oversaw the development of cruise missiles, the B-1 bomber, and a major naval shipbuilding program. In 1977, Rumsfeld was awarded the nation's highest civilian award, the Presidential Medal of Freedom. Kissinger, his bureaucratic adversary, later paid him a different sort of compliment, pronouncing him a special Washington phenomenon, the skilled full-time politician bureaucrat in whom ambition, ability, and substance fuse seamlessly. In early 1977, Rumsfeld briefly lectured at Princeton's Woodrow Wilson School and Northwestern's Kellogg School of Management. His sights instead turned to business, and from 1977 to 1985 Rumsfeld served as Chief Executive Officer, President, and then Chairman of G.D. Searle & Company, a worldwide pharmaceutical company based in Skokie, Illinois. During his tenure at Searle, Rumsfeld led the company's financial turnaround, thereby earning awards as the Outstanding Chief Executive Officer in the pharmaceutical industry from the Wall Street Transcript and Financial World. In 1985, Searle was sold to the Monsanto Company. Rumsfeld served as Chairman and Chief Executive Officer of General Instrument Corporation from 1990 to 1993. A leader in broadband transmission, distribution, and access control technologies for cable, satellite, and terrestrial broadcasting applications, the company pioneered the development of the first all-digital high-definition television technology. After taking the company public and returning it to profitability, Rumsfeld returned to private business in late 1993. From January 1997 until being sworn in as the 21st Secretary of Defense in January 2001, Rumsfeld served as chairman of Gilead Sciences Incorporated. Gilead is the developer of Tamiflu, which is used in the treatment of bird flu. As a result, Rumsfeld's holdings in the company grew significantly when avian flu became a subject of popular anxiety during his later term as Secretary of Defense. Following standard practice, Rumsfeld recused himself from any decisions involving Gilead, and he directed the Pentagon's general counsel to issue instructions outlining what he could and could not be involved in if there were an avian flu pandemic and the Pentagon had to respond. Rumsfeld was named Secretary of Defense soon after President George W. Bush took office in 2001 despite Rumsfeld's past rivalry with the previous President Bush. Bush's first choice, FedEx founder Fred Smith, was unavailable and Vice President-elect Cheney recommended Rumsfeld for the job. Rumsfeld's second tenure as Secretary of Defense cemented him as the most powerful Pentagon chief since Robert McNamara and one of the most influential cabinet members in the Bush administration. His tenure proved to be a pivotal and rocky one that led the United States military into the 21st century. Following the September 11th attacks, Rumsfeld led the military planning and execution of the U.S. invasion of Afghanistan and the subsequent 2003 invasion of Iraq. He pushed hard to send as small a force as soon as possible to both conflicts, a concept codified as the Rumsfeld Doctrine. Throughout his time as defense secretary, Rumsfeld was noted for his candor and quick wit when giving weekly press conferences or speaking with the press. U.S. News and World Report called him a straight-talking Midwesterner who routinely has the press corps doubled over in fits of laughter. By the same token, his leadership was exposed to much criticism through provocative books covering the Iraq conflict, like Bob Woodward's State of Denial, Thomas E. Rick's Fiasco, and Seymour Hersh's Chain of Command. Rumsfeld was named Secretary of Defense soon after President George W. Bush took office in 2001 despite Rumsfeld's past rivalry with the previous President Bush. Bush's first choice, FedEx founder Fred Smith, was unavailable and Vice President-elect Cheney recommended Rumsfeld for the job. Rumsfeld's second tenure as Secretary of Defense cemented him as the most powerful Pentagon chief since Robert McNamara and one of the most influential cabinet members in the Bush administration. His tenure proved to be a pivotal and rocky one that led the United States military into the 21st century. Following the September 11th attacks, Rumsfeld led the military planning and execution of the U.S. invasion of Afghanistan and the subsequent 2003 invasion of Iraq. He pushed hard to send as small a force as soon as possible to both conflicts, a concept codified as the Rumsfeld Doctrine. Throughout his time as defense secretary, Rumsfeld was noted for his candor and quick wit when giving weekly press conferences or speaking with the press. U.S. News and World Report called him a straight-talking Midwesterner who routinely has the press corps doubled over in fits of laughter. By the same token, his leadership was exposed to much criticism through provocative books covering the Iraq conflict, like Bob Woodward's State of Denial, Thomas E. Rick's Fiasco, and Seymour Hersh's Chain of Command. On the afternoon of September 11th, Rumsfeld issued rapid orders to his aides to look for evidence of possible Iraqi involvement in regard to what had just occurred, according to notes taken by senior policy official Stephen Cambone. Best info fast. Judge whether good enough hit SH- meaning Saddam Hussein, at same time. Not only UBL, Cambone's notes quoted Rumsfeld as saying. Need to move swiftly, near-term target needs, go massive, sweep it all up. Things related and not. In the first emergency meeting of the National Security Council on the day of the attacks, Rumsfeld asked, why shouldn't we go against Iraq, not just Al-Qaeda? With his deputy Paul Wolfowitz adding that Iraq was a brittle, oppressive regime that might break easily, it was doable, and, according to John Comfer, from that moment on, he and Wolfowitz used every available opportunity to press the case. The idea was initially rejected at the behest of Secretary of State Colin Powell, but, according to Comfer, undeterred Rumsfeld and Wolfowitz held secret meetings about opening up a second front, against Saddam. Powell was excluded. In such meetings they created a policy that would later be dubbed the Bush Doctrine, centering on preemption in the war on Iraq, which the NAC had advocated in their earlier letters. Rumsfeld directed the planning for the war in Afghanistan after the September 11th attacks. On September 21, 2001, USINCOM Commander General Tommy Franks briefed the president on a plan to destroy Al-Qaeda in Afghanistan and remove the Taliban government. General Franks also initially proposed to Rumsfeld that the U.S. invade Afghanistan using a conventional force of 60,000 troops, preceded by 6 months of preparation. Rumsfeld, however, feared that a conventional invasion of Afghanistan could bog down as had happened to the Soviets and the British. Rumsfeld rejected Franks's plan, saying, "I want men on the ground now." Franks returned the next day with a plan utilizing U.S. special forces. Despite air and missile attacks against Al-Qaeda in Afghanistan, USINCOM had no pre-existing plans for conducting ground operations there. The September 21, 2001 plan emerged after extensive dialogue, but Secretary Rumsfeld also asked for broader plans that looked beyond Afghanistan. On October 7, 2001, just hours after the 2001 invasion of Afghanistan was launched, Rumsfeld addressed the nation in a press conference at the Pentagon stating, "While our raids today focus on the Taliban and the foreign terrorists in Afghanistan, our aim remains much broader. Our objective is to defeat those who use terrorism and those who house or support them. The world stands united in this effort." Rumsfeld also stated the only way to deal with these terrorist threats is to go at them where they exist. You cannot defend at every place at every time against every conceivable, imaginable, even unimaginable terrorist attack. and the only way to deal with it is to take the battle to where they are and to root them out and to starve them out by seeing that those countries and those organizations and those non-governmental organizations and those individuals that are supporting and harboring and facilitating these networks stop doing it and find that there's a penalty for doing it. Before and during the Iraq War, Rumsfeld claimed that Iraq had an active weapons of mass destruction program. In particular, during his famous phrase "there are no knowns" in a press conference at the Pentagon on February 12, 2002, no stockpiles were ever found. Bush administration officials also claimed that there was an operational relationship between Al-Qaeda and Saddam Hussein. A Pentagon Inspector General report found that Rumsfeld's top policy aide, Douglas J. Feith, developed, produced, and then disseminated alternative intelligence assessments on the Iraq and Al-Qaeda relationship, which included some conclusions that were inconsistent with the consensus of the intelligence community, to senior decision makers. The job of finding WMD and providing justification for the attack fell to the intelligence services. But, according to Kompfer, Rumsfeld and Wolfowitz believed that, while the established security services had a role, they were too bureaucratic and too traditional in their thinking. As a result, they set up what came to be known as the Cabal, a cell of 8 or 9 analysts in a new office of special plans based in the U.S. Defense Department. According to an unnamed Pentagon source quoted by Hirsch, the OSB was created in order to find evidence of what Wolfowitz and his boss, Defense Secretary Rumsfeld, believed to be true, that Saddam Hussein had close ties to Al-Qaeda, and that Iraq had an enormous arsenal of chemical, biological, and possibly even nuclear weapons that threatened the region and, potentially, the United States. Throughout his tenure, Rumsfeld sought to remind the American people of the 9/11 attacks and threats against Americans, noting at one time in a 2006 memo to AIC, the American people realize they are surrounded in the world by violent extremists. According to a report by The Guardian, Rumsfeld was allegedly including biblical quotes in top-secret briefing papers to appeal George W. Bush, known for his devout religious beliefs, to invade Iraq as more like holy war or a religious crusade against Muslims. In a September 2007 interview with the Daily Telegraph, General Mike Jackson, the head of the British Army during the invasion, criticized Rumsfeld's plans for the invasion of Iraq as intellectually bankrupt, adding that Rumsfeld is one of those most responsible for the current situation in Iraq, and that he felt that the U.S. approach to combating global terrorism is inadequate and too focused on military might rather than nation-building and diplomacy. The Department of Defense's preliminary concerns for holding, housing, and interrogating captured prisoners on the battlefield were raised during the military buildup prior to the Iraq War. Because Saddam Hussein's military forces surrendered when faced with military action, many within the DoD, including Rumsfeld and United States Central Command General Tommy Franks, decided it was in the best interest of all to hand these prisoners over to their respective countries. Additionally, it was determined that maintaining a large holding facility was, at the time, unrealistic. Instead, the use of many facilities such as Abu Ghraib to house prisoners of interest prior to handing them over, and Rumsfeld defended the Bush administration's decision to detain enemy combatants. Because of this, critics, including members of the U.S. Senate Armed Services Committee, held Rumsfeld responsible for the ensuing Abu Ghraib torture and prisoner abuse scandal. Rumsfeld himself said, "These events occurred on my watch as Secretary of Defense. I am accountable for them." He offered his resignation to President Bush in the wake of the scandal, but it was not accepted. 8 U.S. and other NATO member retired generals and admirals called for Rumsfeld to resign in early 2006 in what was called the General's Revolt, accusing him of abysmal military planning and lack of strategic competence. Commentator Pat Buchanan reported at the time that Washington Post columnist David Ignatius, who traveled often to Iraq and supported the war, said the generals mirror the views of 75% of the officers in the field, and probably more. Rumsfeld rebuffed these criticisms, stating, "Out of thousands and thousands of admirals and generals, if every time 2 or 3 people disagreed we changed the Secretary of Defense of the United States, it would be like a merry-go-round." Bush defended Rumsfeld throughout and responded by stating that Rumsfeld is exactly what is needed. Rumsfeld shakes President Bush's hand as he announces his resignation, November 8, 2006. On November 1, 2006, Bush stated he would stand by Rumsfeld as defense secretary for the length of his term as president. Rumsfeld wrote a resignation letter dated November 6, 2006, and, for the stamp on the letter, Bush saw it on election day, November 7, 2006. In the elections, the House and the Senate shifted to Democratic control. After the elections on November 8, 2006, Bush announced Rumsfeld would resign his position as Secretary of Defense. Many Republicans were unhappy with the delay, believing they would have won more votes if voters had known Rumsfeld was resigning. Bush nominated Robert Gates to succeed Rumsfeld. On December 18, 2006, Rumsfeld's resignation took effect. In the months after his resignation, Rumsfeld toured the New York City publishing houses in preparation for a potential memoir. After receiving what one industry source labeled big bids, he reached an agreement with the Penguin Group to publish the book under its Sentinel HC imprint. Rumsfeld declined to accept an advance for the publication of his memoir, and said he was donating all proceeds from the work to veterans groups. His book, entitled Known and Unknown, a memoir, was released on February 8, 2011. In conjunction with the publication of Known and Unknown, Rumsfeld established the Rumsfeld Papers, a website with documents related to the endnotes of the book and his service during the George W. Bush administration. During the months that followed the book's publication, the website was expanded to include over 4,000 documents from his archive. As of June 2011, the topics included his congressional voting record, the Nixon administration, documents and memos of meetings while he was part of the Ford, Reagan, and George W. Bush administrations, private sector documents, and NATO documents, among other items. In January 2016, in partnership with the literary and creative agency Javelin, which handled design and development, Rumsfeld released a mobile app game of solitaire called Churchill Solitaire, emulating a variant of the card game as played by Winston Churchill. Rumsfeld and the Churchill family said that profits from the game would be donated to charity. In June 2016, Rumsfeld announced that he would vote for Donald Trump in the 2016 presidential election. On June 29, 2021, Rumsfeld died from multiple myeloma at his home in Taos, New Mexico, at the age of 88.